It's the same hustle, it's the same pain. Same tears on everything. Maybe one day we'll see. We're one big family. Like it's one.
You. Today's topic is DNA, the new one drop rule. There's a lot of people have questions about this DNA testing and how it relates to your ancestry.
Yes.
Okay.
And according to Genetics Home Reference, which is a service of the United States National Library of Medicine, and they say that genetic testing or genetic genealogy is a way for people interested in family history or their genealogy to go beyond what they can learn from relatives or from historical documentation.
Well, let's see how much truth is coming out of these DNA testing.
Right. Okay, but first of all, there are three different types of genetic testing.
Okay.
One type of testing is just the Y chromosome testing. And the Y chromosome testing is when they use what the chromosomes that have been passed exclusively from father to son.
Okay, so they're testing your father's side.
Your father's side of the family.
Okay.
So females will not be able to do this. They would have to get a male
relative.
A
different test, because we'll get to that test next.
Yes.
Okay.
Then you have mitochondrial DNA testing.
Right.
Okay. And the mitochondrial DNA testing, it provides information on the direct female ancestral line.
Okay.
So this tests the female side. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what is interesting, though, is that men do carry the mitochondrial DNA, but they do not pass it on to any to their offspring.
Right.
So a male can do a mitochondrial DNA testing along with the females.
So
both male and female can do the mitochondrial testing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it's just that the males do not pass that on to their
to the next generation.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
It's only transferred through the mother.
Through the mother.
All right. And then
in the female line.
The third test.
The third test, which is called single nucleotide polymorphism.
Okay. All right.
And it's also, they call it SNP testing.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
And this testing, it says it is to provide an estimate of a person's ethnic background by observing ancestral markers or mutations, which are little changes that occur in the genetic code of the mitochondrial DNA.
Okay. So for the third testing, you know, just to make sure that the audience is clear, so when they're testing you for your ethnicity, or, you know, when they're doing that cultural test that a lot of people are trying to do to figure out where they came from, or if they have any Native American blood in them, or whatever you're testing for, they're using the female test.
They're using the mitochondrial DNA.
Mm-hmm.
And they're looking for little mutations or little things that change that will
signify a different ethnic path.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. So those are the three tests.
Those are the three tests. Yes. Okay.
You know, there's a lot of misinformation going on around in reference to where the test came from, what it relates to, and how it's used. And so, you know, let's clear up some of the myths about that and figure out, you know, what's really going on with this test.
1981 is when they finally figured out the entire DNA sequence.
Okay.
And this was done in London.
Mm-hmm.
And it was really a placenta, really, was provided from a local hospital.
Okay, cool.
And the placenta was from a European male in London.
Okay.
And this was the person that they did the testing on. They used the placenta and they did testing and testing and testing until they finally figured out the whole DNA chain.
Uh-huh.
Okay, which happened in 1981.
Okay, so that was the first time in 81, it was the first time that a DNA sequence had been published.
And totally completed.
Okay.
And published, yes.
Okay.
And so it was published by Cambridge University in England.
Okay.
And this person whose DNA that they used, it was called the Cambridge Reference Sequence, or the CRS.
Okay.
Okay.
CRS. We want to remember that for later, but the CRS.
Yes.
Okay.
Now, in the 1990s, they noticed that there were some little things and a couple of little hiccups that were a couple little mistakes that they wanted to correct.
Okay.
So they went back, and now what they have is an R CRS, which is revised.
Okay.
It's just the revised version, mm-hmm. but it's still using the original placenta, so nothing has really changed as far as that DNA sequence is
okay.
is concerned.
All right. Now,
and this sequence is now what they call ground zero.
Ground zero. Okay.
Right. And it is the CNA, that is the DNA that all DNA mm-hmm. is compared to.
Okay, so let's pause for a minute because that matters.
Oh,
that,
yes.
It matters deeply. Now, and so we're not, so what we're saying is that someone that was born in 1981, around 1980s, DNA was sequenced, and this is the reference sequence that we compare everybody else's DNA to.
Yes.
So we don't compare to, as I've heard some say, Lucy
right.
or mitochondrial Eve. We don't compare to anything beyond 1980. It starts at 1981 with that Cambridge reference sequence.
Right, that's correct. And most people do not realize that. You know, most people would think, because again, you would think that if you're doing the sequencing, that it would be done from the earliest DNA
right, that they can
that
find.
You can find.
Right.
Okay.
Well, human DNA.
Yes, human DNA. Yes. Okay.
Because
all living things have DNA.
Well, and just to hold for a second, for those who think that Lucy was used as the DNA pattern to sequence everybody, well, Lucy was not even human.
Lucy was not human.
So she was not a Homo sapiens.
She was not a Homo sapien.
So
she preceded Homo sapiens.
And so she wouldn't even really. It really wouldn't even make sense for us to try to use Lucy's DNA patterns to sequence us.
That's correct, because there would be differences.
Right, because they're different species.
Because she was not, she was not a modern human.
Okay, and again, just to make sure y'all understand, Lucy was not used as the reference sequence to do the DNA analysis for your genetic ancestry.
Okay, and I also want to point this out, though. It says that comparing, you know, it would make sense to compare our DNA to the earliest human, all right?
Mm-hmm.
But it says, however, it says that is not how the research community has decided to approach mitochondrial DNA. The consensus within the scientific community is that mitochondrial DNA is always compared to CRS. Now, there is a testing out which is called the reconstructed sapiens reference sequence,
okay,
which is called RSRS, okay?
Okay.
All right, but they use the DNA from the mitochondrial Eve.
Okay.
All right. Not Lucy, but mitochondrial Eve.
Mm-hmm.
They do use that DNA, okay? It says, however, and this is also coming from the United States National Library of Medicine,
mm-hmm.
they state, it is therefore neither necessary nor sensible to change the present reference sequence, the RCRS, in any way. Mm. The proposed switch to RSRS would inevitably lead to notational chaos, mistakes, and misinterpretations. This is what they say, and so this is why they do not want to go to mitochondrial Eve.
Mm-hmm.
They just want to leave it at the CRS.
And this is the United States National, who's saying this?
Okay, this is the United States National Library of Medicine.
Okay, and so although it could be a better test out there that would sequence individuals from a better perspective, us as human beings, they're not going to use this test because it's just going to cause too much chaos.
Too much confusion.
Because they've been using this number, they've been using this system for so long, we might as well keep it the same.
Oh, yes, that's the 90s.
Since the 90s.
That's too long.
Well, you know, before we go, matter of fact, before we go, let me just point out that even that sequence system has its issues. You know, because that sequence, the sequencing where they reference the Homo sapiens, they're testing individuals from today's location and not necessarily the individual's location in ancient times, or as it doesn't take into account migration patterns of individuals.
Right, so they're taking modern humans who are, let's just say in Africa.
Okay.
So they're using the modern humans that are right in Africa in the areas today.
Mm-hmm. So let's say that they could literally test white African from South America, consider them African, and now the the testing could be flawed in some way because this person is not necessarily indigenous to that part of the country.
That's correct.
You know, and they're not taking that in consideration.
That's correct, and they haven't done that in anywhere. You know, So, in Europe, Africa, wherever,
Americas.
People have traveled over tens of thousands of years. And so if you're in a place today, it does not mean that your ancestors were there 2,000 years ago, 200 years ago.
Okay. Well, it's a lot more to discuss about this topic. So let's take a small break and we'll be right back. So now that we have that background information, we know that it's from this time period, from, this European individual, and not from anything prior, to her. Let's talk about the test itself and what they're actually testing for when they do each one of these tests.
Okay. Well, when they do the genetic testing, they are... And let me refer to my people here. Okay, when you're testing, you're either testing the Y DNA or the mitochondrial DNA, which is going to give you information about your father's father's father or your mother's mother's mother. However, it doesn't give you anything in between.
Okay, so in between. you're following your father's father's father, and you're following your mother's mother's mother, but you're not hitting anybody in between. Please, explain that for us.
Okay, so now, if you're testing your four great-grandmothers, okay?
Right.
You and all your brothers and sisters have inherited the mitochondrial DNA from your maternal grandmother's mother, all right?
Okay, so...
That's your grandmother's mother.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The other three great-grandmothers that you have not contributed to your DNA.
So
that means that your mother's, your great-grandfather didn't contribute.
Okay.
Your father's mother's grandmother did not contribute.
Okay.
And your father's grandfather did not contribute.
Okay.
So none of those people have contributed to your DNA.
Mm-hmm.
However, if they, so you're missing out on seven of your eight grandparents, great-grandparents.
Right, so they're not even going to test for anyone else. They're just going to follow just this one line.
Just the one line.
Ignoring the fact that in order for this one line to occur, you have to have had so many different branches of offshoots. You have to have grandparents on both sides. You have to have great-grandparents that come from both sides of both of those sides.
Yes.
The family tree grows and grows and grows.
Yes.
But they're excluding the family tree.
They're excluding just about all of the family tree.
Okay.
So if you take into consideration of your great-grandparents, all right, if your father's grandfather was a Native American.
Okay.
It's not going to show up in your DNA.
Mm-hmm.
Even if your grandmother's father was a Native American, it is not going to show up in the DNA testing.
Okay. Okay.
So seven of your eight grandparents, great grandparents, could be Indian, but it's not going to show up in your DNA test because they're only testing that one person that is the direct maternal line.
The further back in time we go, the more people they are excluding out of your out of your history.
That's correct. So if you go back as far as, let's say, your great-great-great-grandparents, you have 32 of them.
Okay, right.
31 of them
will not be counted.
Will not be counted.
Wow. Well, let's talk about this is only for the mitochondria, or is this for both the mitochondrial test and the DNA test?
And the Y test.
Yeah.
Well, it works the same way.
It works
the same way because, again, when you're doing the Y DNA testing, you're only testing the father and the father's father, the father's father's father, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So it is still doing the same thing. You are still omitting most of the people.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing is this, is that not only, now, again, we have to remember that when they do identify, well, let's say they're identifying someone as a Native American.
Okay.
And they call those little markers, they call them haplotypes,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Mm-hmm.
And so now, if that great-great-grandmother did not have one of the five haplotypes that are designated as Native American,
okay,
then they're still not going to be identified as Native American.
Okay, well, let's pause there for a second.
Mm-hmm.
And so they have these markers that they identify as being, which would identify someone from being of a particular culture
or
a particular area or region.
Yes.
And so as far as Native Americans are concerned, they have tested five groups.
They have identified five.
They have identified five.
Five, yes.
Out of, have they tested all of the different or various Native Americans?
Okay, well, see, that's the thing.
Right.
There were thousands of tribes
mm-hmm.
when the Europeans arrived here, you know.
Right.
Even today, even as far as the BIA is concerned,
exactly.
there's like 450 some, I do believe, tribes that are recognized tribes within the United States.
And that's not even going to include the unamalgamated tribes.
That's correct. It's not. Mm-hmm. It's not even including those, and they have not tested everyone from each one of those tribes. And so it's like, so we still don't know if they have identified all of the Native American markers.
Because they only have five groups for the Native American population itself. We have to question the test in the first place, because it's excluding some of us.
Yes, because again, they haven't tested all of the tribes.
It's excluding some of their own recognized tribes.
It may be. And until they do all of that testing, we will never know.
All right, well, let's go back. Okay, so now that we understand that, let's go back to the chart for a second, because something seems very, very eerily similar to me with respect to this conversation. And so we're going to go back. And, you know, let's go back to some of the colonial laws. And discuss how this DNA test, to me, really represents a newer version of colonial laws. Let's speak about we could talk about the 1/4 or the 1/16.
Yes.
You know, we could speak about the one drop rule.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, and let's compare some charts. Let's compare a chart of a colonial law referencing slaves and its DNA test, and let's see how similar these charts are.
Well, really, if we talk about our great-great-grandparents, the chart really looks exactly the same as the 1/16 rule
mm-hmm.
that they had for Native Americans back in the early 1900s.
Mm-hmm.
There were legislative acts which stated that if you had 1/16 or more black blood or slave blood,
mm-hmm.
then you were considered African in descent.
Right.
So again.
So because you could have 15 great-grandparents that were from
Native Americans.
One that was identified as a Negro, whether they could have been Native American, they could not have been, but just because they were identified as a Negro or a slave, or they now you're African. If we put this chart next to a chart that's reference your DNA, it's the same chart.
It is the same chart, and it is showing the same thing.
And
it is showing that out of your 16 great-great-grandparents, 15 of them could have been full-blooded Indians, Native Americans, but because of that one that was identified as a Negro, that means that you would be considered a Negro, even though most of your ancestry is Native American.
Mm, yeah, and then we can take it a step further, because then you go back to that one drop rule. And again, the further and back in time these DNA tests will take you, the more and more individuals they will leave out of your family history. And again, with that one drop rule, you go back any further and further, it doesn't matter to them. You know, if that one person is identified, no matter who else is in your family tree, you are who you are, and it doesn't matter to us.
That's correct.
Yes. Yeah. You know, we have a couple of people that send us comments. You know, a couple of people will send us their sequencing tests from places, Ancestry.com, some of the other places, and they, you know, well, this is what my DNA sequence said. And, you know, basically what you're doing is you're sending a sample of your blood to these organizations, and they're doing these t- testings, that they test this against your blood.
Okay, well, not necessarily blood, because they can just do a swab.
Oh, that's right. You know, they could take it. They could get your DNA from anywhere.
Yes.
Now,
yeah, and that's what they're doing. They're doing swabs.
Okay.
Now.
Okay. Yeah. So they do swabs now, and they sequence you, and they figure out who you are, and they send you back to test.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what else do they do with these tests? You know.
Yes, and what do they do with the results?
Yeah, what do they do with the results? You know, and I take a look at it. Go look up online and see for yourself what they do with these results. You know, it's in Iowa. They're talking about an issue where Ancestry.com actually gave their database to a police precinct that was looking for a murderer. They thought that they found somebody that DNA matched. They tricked him into coming back into the state, locked him up, only to find out that it was not him, you know, and his father was the person that actually donated his, gave him a sample so that he can get his DNA sequence. And, you know, 10 years later, his son is getting locked up for a crime that he didn't commit, you know, on a trick that the police precinct played against him off some false information that Ancestry.com gave them in reference to a DNA. So you got to really consider, you know, not only who is giving you this test, what they're basing these tests off of, and what's their motive for giving you the answers that you are getting, but what they're doing with your information afterwards. You know, you really got to be careful about what you are offering to the public.
You may not know where your DNA is going to end up.
You know, and I'm sorry, but I have to say, just like I've found a lot of other scientists say, which is that, you know, this could amount to some sorts of fraudulent activity on some individuals' parts, because they're telling you that they can give you something that they actually cannot.
Right, because they really cannot tell you your ancestry by just tracing only one individual out of the hundreds, and further back you go, thousands mm-hmm. of people who are in your ancestry. There's no way that they can tell you all of that information.
It's, again, like I said, it's like the new one drop rule.
It's almost, it seems like a form of genocide mm-hmm. as far as Native Americans are concerned.
All over again, you know, and a mental genocide, you know, rather than that physical genocide. Let's just totally erase them by offering them every, you know, things that are not proven, are not scientifically sound. Although we know these things not to be, we're going to sell them to you as they are, because, you know, it's capitalism at its finest.